Welcome to worship at Zion today. Everybody thought out, getting there, work at it. You can sit on your hands or you can clap your hands, whatever works for you. Our opening hymn today is a song that we learned. I think we sang for the first time last week. Our choir led the song, and we're going to try it again. A beautiful song, really, a little bit tricky, but we'll sing hymn number 331, As the Deer Runs to the River.
As the deer runs to the river, parched and weary from the chase, we have come from hurt and hurry, thirsting for your healing grace. Jesus, source of living water, may we drink of you and live. When your Israel crossed the desert, where no stream or spring was seen, Moses struck the rock and water flowed for them, refreshing clean. Jesus, source of living water, may we drink of you and live. Come and drink, Isaiah summoned, all who for God's mercy plead. God's forgiveness like a fountain flows to satisfy your need. Jesus, source of living water, may we drink of you and live. Christ, we come from desert places, deepest thirst unsatisfied. Lead us to the waters flowing from the cross on which you died. Jesus, source of living water, may we drink of you and live.
A few announcements as we start our worship time together. We have a video from our ZIG, Zion Youth Group. Some of our high school kids put this together. So hopefully, there we go.
Until it all runs. Captain America has been the bravest superhero. I've seen Captain America die about 4 or 5 times. Superman, too.
It's gone. I already pressed it.
All right, Hulk Heroes, fly on over.
1, 2, 3.
Hulk Splash! Thank you.
That was the whole world.
I'm out of there. Okay. Awesome. I had the opportunity to go on that polar plunge, and I'm glad I didn't. So, there is always next year, yes. Awesome bunch of kids and families. So, thank you, everyone, for doing that. Also, words of thanks for. Those who gave donations to our food pantry through our Thrivent challenge last month, to date, $4,170 came in for our food pantry. Thrivent had challenged us to raise $1,000 for, and then they would give us $500. So we're at about $4,700, probably more than that by now for just food pantry donations last month. So thank you, everyone, for your gracious and generous support on the behalf of people who need help. At our second service today, we celebrate the gift of new life. A little boy named Elliot is going to be baptized, and we are so excited for that. His little brothers have been talking about it in Sunday school the last month, and they're getting charged. They're ready to be a part of the action, so we're grateful for that. Speaking of the gift of new life, we said goodbye to an old friend of ours, Biola Francis. LaVon Johnson's mother passed away, and her service was held last week at the BB Funeral Chapel up in New Richmond, and the flowers on the altar are in her memory from that funeral. This coming week is another time of change. This is the beginning of our Lenten services, and Ash Wednesday is a traditionally somber kind of thing. We bring our sins to God, and that's kind of where it starts. And the mark of the ashes on the forehead are a reminder of our own mortality. As we go through that service, we also receive the gift of Holy Communion, and that is the gift of forgiveness. Ash Wednesday, in some people's books, is a real downer because it's just sort of like kind of gray. You know, it's not really the kick up your heels kind of thing. But I think if we can face our own lives honestly and acknowledge our sin, the forgiveness that the Lord provides is all the sweeter. So please join us on Wednesday evening for supper at 5:30. Let's see, our 8th grade Bible campers are serving that dinner, and any donations for the dinner will help them with their cost for Bible camp this summer. Also, worship at 7 o'clock with Holy Communion, and of course, everyone is welcome. Later on in our service, we'll hear from Kristen Thompson. Kristen is a guest with us today from the St. Croix County Family Resource Center, and she will be telling us a little bit about how we can be involved in the mission that they have, reaching out to families throughout our area. We continue at this point in the front portion of our hymnal on page 94 with the confession of our sins, and we hear words of the Lord's forgiveness. We are gathered in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We offer together the prayer of the day. It is printed in the worship folder. And we pray, God of sight, too often we are spiritually blind, unable to see you working in our world. Give us your light so that we may see, and help us to be light for others. Amen. We hear the scripture reading at this time. From John chapter 9, verses 1 through 41. As he went along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? Neither this man nor his parents sinned, said Jesus, but this happened so that the works of God might be displayed in him. As long as it is day, we must do the works of him who sent me. Night is coming, when no one can work. While I am in the world, I am the light of the world. Having said this, he spit on the ground made some mud with the saliva and put it on the man's eyes. Go, he told him, wash it in the pool of Siloam. This word means sent. So the man went and washed and came home seeing. His neighbors and those who had formerly seen him begging asked, isn't this the same man who used to sit and beg? Some claimed that he was. Others said, no, he only looks like him. But he himself insisted, I am the man. How then were your eyes opened? They asked. He replied, the man they call Jesus made some mud and put it on my eyes. He told me to go to Siloam and wash. So I went and washed. And then I could see. Where is this man? They asked him. I don't know, he said. They brought to the Pharisee the man who had been blind. Now the day on which Jesus had made the mud and opened the man's eyes was a Sabbath. Therefore, the Pharisees also asked him how he had received his sight. He put mud on my eyes, the man replied, and I washed, and now I see. Some of the Pharisees said, this man is not from God, for he does not keep the Sabbath. But others asked, how can a sinner perform such signs? So they were divided. Then they turned again to the blind man. What have you to say about him? It was your eyes he opened. The man replied, he is a prophet. They still did not believe that he had been blind and had received his sight until they sent for the man's parents. Is this your son? They asked. Is this the one you say was born blind? How is it that now he can see? We know he is our son, the parents answered, and we know he was born blind, but how he can see now, or who opened his eyes, we don't know. Ask him. He is of age. He will speak for himself. His parents said this because they were afraid of the Jewish leaders, who already had decided that anyone who acknowledged that Jesus was the Messiah would be put out of the synagogue. That was why his parents said, he is of age, ask him. A second time they summoned the man who had been blind. Give glory to God and tell the truth, they said. We know this man is a sinner. He replied, whether he is a sinner or not, I don't know. One thing I do know, I was blind, but now I see. Then they asked him, what did he do to you? How did he open your eyes? He answered, I have told you already, and you did not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you want to become his disciples too? Then they hurled insults at him and said, you are this fellow's disciple. We are disciples of Moses. We know that God spoke to Moses, but as for this fellow, we don't even know where he comes from. The man answered, now that is remarkable. You don't know where he comes from, yet he opened my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners. He listens to the godly person who does his will. Nobody has ever heard of opening the eyes of a man born blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing. To this they replied, you were steeped in sin at birth. How dare you lecture us? And they threw him out. Jesus heard that they had thrown him out. And when he found him, he said, do you believe in the Son of Man? Who is he, sir? The man asked. Tell me so that I may believe in him. Jesus said, you have now seen him. In fact, he is the one speaking with you. Then the man said, Lord, I believe. And he worshiped him. Jesus said, for judgment I have come into this world, so that the blind will see, and those who see will become blind. Some Pharisees who were with him heard him say this and asked, what? Are we blind too? Jesus said, if you were blind, you would not be guilty of sin, but now that you claim you can see, your guilt remains. This is God's word. Thanks be to God. I'd like to invite our kids to come up at this time.
you doing?
Good. Me too. We'll sit here. We'll chat a little bit. Hi. Hello. How are you doing? Good. Me too. Hey. Good to see you all today. Have any of you ever been sick and you needed somebody to help take care of you? Yeah? What can you tell me about that? You just don't want to tell them about that, right? Yeah, well, okay, that's all right. You don't have to tell them. You don't have to tell me either. But you kind of know what it's about, right? You're not feeling good. Who took care of you during that time? This is not a trick question. This is just... Who took care of you when you were not feeling good?
My mom.
Your mom? Yeah? Yep. Anybody else take care of you when you're not feeling good? Moms are awesome at that. I remember my mom taking care of me many years ago when I was sick. Have you ever been to a doctor? Yeah? They take care of you when you were sick? I think that's part of what they do too. So why do these people take care of you when you're sick? You don't know? Nah, I do. What do you think?
Can they help you get better?
They can help you get better, yes. Yes. And they do it. I think your mom does it, or your dad, or your grandpa or grandma or whoever. I think they do it because they love you. What do you think of that? They care about you. They don't want you to just be sick, 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 blah, 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 blah. And they'll say, oh, honey, oh, what can I do for you? Can I help you? And they do help you because they love you. Maybe you go to the doctor. Maybe your doctor loves you too. But maybe your doctor helps because that's just what your doctor is supposed to do. They took an oath and they said, I promise I will do everything in my power and with the medicine and stuff around me to help people feel better. They do their very best. Because they're supposed to, and they promised they would. We heard a story here about a man who was born blind, and Jesus helped him to see again. He was not doing so well. Jesus helped him out, and why do you think Jesus helped him? Not a trick question. I think Jesus helped him because he loved him. And I think Jesus helped him because that's what he was supposed to do. He came to be a servant. He came to help. Now, we are Christians. We believe in Jesus. And if Jesus is a part of us, that same job has been given to us, to help take care of people. Maybe because we love them. Hopefully we can love the whole world the way Jesus loves the whole world. Maybe we help people just because that's what we're supposed to do. It might not be our favorite thing to do, but we still do it. We still help because that's part of what it means to be a Christian. If Jesus is in us, then we will do the things that Jesus does. Let's take a moment to pray, and then we will learn some good ways that we can help people. Thank you, Jesus, for this beautiful day that you've given to us, and thank you for the time that we have to be together. There are so many things that we see in our world that do need healing, and sometimes we don't know what to do, but we ask that you would show us the way and that you would empower our hearts and our minds and our spirits to do what we need to do because of our love for you, because of your love for us. In your name we pray, Jesus. Amen. You may be seated, and thanks for coming up. And I invite Kristen Thompson to come up and share a mission moment with us now.
Good morning. Good morning. I'm Kristen Thompson from the Family Resource Center, St. Croix Valley. Thank you for the opportunity to be here with you this morning. I'm pleased to share about our programs and hope there may be some folks in the congregation this morning that may wish to become more involved. Family Resource Center St. Croix Valley was founded in 1998, initially to serve St. Croix County, and now we've expanded serving also Polk and Pierce counties as well. We offer programs for families with children prenatal through school entry, and we have parent educators visiting in 6 partner hospitals when new babies are born. We host Baby and Me classes in partnership with these hospitals and United Way St. Croix Valley as well. And we have 9 play and learn groups across all 3 counties for families with toddlers and preschoolers. We also have 2 young parent programs for pregnant and parenting teens. Through our home visiting program, we serve 130 families annually, and we serve about 2,000 people across these 3 counties annually. Our mission is to strengthen children, families, and communities by offering education, resources, and support, and all of our programming is offered to families at no cost. I want to share with you a story of a family that has been participating in programs for a few years, just to give a little more insight into how families come into being involved and how they remain involved over their child's early years. Angela and Barry had their first child in June of 2010, and their son experienced some respiratory complications, so he was almost transferred to the hospitals in the cities. While still in the hospital, they received a visit from a parent educator and had a follow-up visit in their home 2 weeks later. As new parents, they didn't have much experience with young children, and mom was raised by her father, and so she didn't have her mother available when questions arose. Angela and Barry decided to continue with the home visiting program to receive ongoing information as well as activities to do with their son to support his growth and development. Angela grew more confident in her parenting and decided to enroll in the Play and Learn group shortly after Charlie turned 1 year old. Over the years, this family has found support from their parent educator, not only through the parenting and developmental information given, but also having someone to talk to when times get tough. The couple separated for a period of time and experienced homelessness. Charlie went back and forth between mom and dad, whoever had a place to stay for the night. Through visits with the parent educator, they did regular developmental screenings, and at one point it was determined that Charlie was behind in speech and language development. The parent educator was able to assist the family in connecting with Birth to Three services, and the child has since graduated from Birth to Three and is beginning the early childhood program. Mom struggled in school growing up, and so she has always had the goal of having her children be successful in school. She was not aware of early childhood services available to her family until Family Resource Center assisted her in connecting with them. The family has continued attending the Play and Learn group and found support in the community through making new friends with families that have children the same ages. For Angela, the most helpful parent discussion topics have been the car seat safety conversations and as well as challenging behaviors with toddlers. With the weekly discussions, she knows she's not alone, and all parents are going through many of the same struggles that she deals with. This mom struggled after suffering a miscarriage, but has since given birth to a healthy daughter this past fall. And she is now attending one of our Baby and Me groups as well to have one-on-one time with her youngest child and focus on her developmental stages. She has appreciated the support in the home visits, with having the transition of a second child in the family. When asked what has meant to be part of Family Resource Center's home visiting program, Angela responded by saying, "I know I always have someone there to talk about the joys and struggles of parenting. There is someone to tell you what to expect next in your child's development and assist you when a concern does arise." She reports her favorite part of home visiting is the activities brought into the home. These activities teach them the importance of playing with their child and give them ideas of developmentally appropriate activities. Family Resource Center is a nonprofit organization, and we rely on grants, contracts with hospitals and county human services, and private donations from individuals. We have an annual fundraiser coming up this spring, which you're all very welcome to attend if you'd like. I have some information about the event as well as our organization overall out in the fellowship hall. And so if you'd like to chat after the service, I'll be here all morning. I'm glad to talk with you further. In addition, Marla Butler, who's a member of the congregation here, she's been a parent educator at Family Resource Center for many years, and she's certainly a resource for you as well. So thanks again for the opportunity to be here this morning, and I hope you'll find a way possibly to become involved or share information with families you know with young children in the community. Thank you.
Thank you, Kristen. As we think about our mission, we find that oftentimes the missions that we don't see very easily are the ones that are closest to us. So I appreciate hearing from the Family Resource Center today, and thank you for being here. We take a moment as we pray. Gracious God, you have given us your word in such a way that it does open our hearts and minds to at least question and perhaps even to have faith. And so as we come here with faith, we are able to ask some questions, and we are able to move a little bit deeper into our world with a faith that is able to challenge many, many obstacles. So we place this time into your hands, and we place our hearts and our lives into your care. Speak to us, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we continue reading the Gospel of John, and we encounter a man in this Bible reading who was born blind. Jesus continues with his typical mystical rhetoric. I don't know what else to call it. The Gospel of John is strange. It is difficult to read in many ways, but Jesus says things that just don't seem to ever really fit in. Today, he says, "I am the light of the world." We've talked over the last couple of months of how Jesus introduces himself to the people around him, and almost every step of the way, people are baffled by what he has said. In this Bible reading, as in last week's reading from John chapter 7, we hear that people are divided again because of what Jesus said. So we look at what Jesus said if we're going to find out why this problem keeps coming up. Why every time now Jesus says something, people are at each other's throats. Jesus opened the eyes of a man born blind. And while he did this, he said, "I am the light of the world." That's me. I am the light of the world, is what Jesus said. That's about all he said, but the controversy began again. The questions started to come up. Well, why is this man blind? What did he do wrong? Oh, no, it wasn't him. Well, then what did his parents do wrong that he was born blind? Oh, no, it wasn't them either. Well, then this Jesus is the problem. What did he do wrong? Looking for fault. Do you see the kind of the common thread that keeps tying this together and messing it up all at the same time? Jesus must be the sinner, then, they declared. And then the Pool of Siloam comes on into the conversation. That was a place that was intended for healing. But hold on a minute. What's going to happen if this Pool of Siloam, if this place for healing is actually a place of healing? What's next? People didn't expect that. They didn't really expect that a place of healing could be a place of healing. And then Jesus comes on and he kind of raises the bar a little bit. Then what is even the strangest thing of all, this man who is born blind speaks the truth. He just says what he knows. He speaks the truth, and that is one thing, truth. that would not be tolerated in this situation. Does that seem strange to you? That's where this story goes. Read it again, and you will see that it is just one jumbled mess. Now, I don't think the blind man intended to create a mess by receiving a gift of healing. And I really don't think Jesus just tried to make a mess of everything by offering this healing gift of grace. But human nature, being what it is, just has to question sometimes, even when good things happen. If something seems too good to be true, better start asking questions. As I read through this reading again today, a thought that crossed my mind is, why did these Pharisees just keep going at it? Why didn't they just say, oh, forget about him and be done with it? They kept asking and kind of created a stir. They created faith by their doubting questions. So sometimes when good things happen, we just can't quite believe it. And Jesus blesses those good things, and people can still be divided, even because of that. So the open eyes see something. And the open eyes now start to say something. And as we read these words, we believe that God is talking to us. God's word really is a word for us. As we read these words, we believe that God is talking to us. God's word is a word for us. This story first occurred in a very specific time, in a very specific place, at a very specific time. So there were people, real people, who were on the scene at the time. And so Jesus spoke to that poor blind beggar so many years ago, but God's word is never finished speaking. God continues to speak through his word, and it has spoken through the centuries, and now God's word is speaking to us. Jesus is speaking to us today, and the words do not change. Jesus is still the light of the world. Jesus is still the way for us to see the path on which we walk. But as we are given light, as we are given sight, as we are given a path to walk, we see what is sometimes a mess in this life. It is the same mess today that was witnessed by the Pharisees so long ago. It was witnessed by the blind man and his parents and Jesus and all the others who started to ask questions about what is right and wrong in this life and who deserves which punishment for which sins. And all Jesus does is gives a blind man sight. He opens eyes. We have sight. We can see this world in which we live. Today we have a mission moment in which we see ways to help people live more successfully in life. Now it's understandable if there are divisions among us and throughout our society when it comes to helping people and how that help is to be given. It's understandable. We argue decisively about those very things in all of our political arenas. We argue about that around cups of coffee while we're sharing ideologies and conceptions and even sharing misconceptions. We have some very strong opinions. And what's right is right, and what's wrong is bad. Get it? Maybe the division is there, and we get it. That's just the way it is. We see it everywhere we go in our society. So with that in mind, the church, is a fragment of the larger society, in which we can reflect the unities and the divisions that are a part of every aspect of life, because this is the real world right here, this gathering of people. We are not surprised when brothers and sisters in Christ, just as neighbors in society, agree or disagree with one another. People were divided over what Jesus said because he was touching real lives and real situations in his society. A beggar at the side of the road was a real issue in Jesus' day. I hope it is in our world today too. Jesus likewise calls us to be involved in our world. And as Jesus opens the eyes of the blind, may we all open our hearts to his healing so that we can see the world as it is in our midst. Jesus opens the eyes of our hearts so that we can look to others with empathy and love. Jesus challenges us each and every day to live as servants. So how will you serve as an individual? How will we serve as the body of Christ right here in Woodville, Wisconsin? We have a place and we have many tasks. How do we shine the light of Christ into this world that does not always see him as he truly is? Jesus came to us with a command, one command. One command Jesus gave to us. And the words of that command are very simply stated, but not all that easy to pull off. The command given in John 13, we'll get to that in a few weeks. John 13, verses 34 and 35 is this: a new command I give you, Jesus said, love one another as I have loved you, so you must love one another. This command to love one another is repeated in the letter to the Romans in chapter 13. It is repeated again in 1 Peter chapters 1 and 3. Love one another the way Jesus loves. The little book of 1 John, way at the end of the Bible, is flooded with that phrase, love one another the way Jesus loves us. We see it again in 2 John chapter 1, love one another. We see an eye-opening love here in John chapter 9. And so we pray that our eyes can be opened to the love and power of Jesus. We pray that our eyes can be opened to the needs of the needy. We pray that our eyes can be opened to the possibilities of loving Christian service. We, like Christ, are not here to be served, but to serve and to love and to spread the good news so that all the world can see the love of Christ in action. Amen. At this time, we ask our ushers to wait upon us as we give our offerings.
Thank you.
We gather at this table of grace and we confess our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. Please stand as you are able. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our Lord Jesus, on the night in which he was betrayed, took the bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." And we offer our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated, and the ushers will lead you forward for Holy Communion. Everyone who worships here, who comes to Christ, is welcome to receive this gift of grace through the bread. We receive the body of Christ through the wine and the grape juice. We receive the blood of Christ. Those who abstain from alcohol, the center ring of each tray is prepared for you. And also those who would like a gluten-free wafer, they're in the glass dish in the center of the table. If you pick up the wafer and hold it up for the blessing as you come forward to receive the sacrament, Holy Communion is prepared. Songs that may be sung during Holy Communion are listed in the bulletin. Gracious Lord, we thank you for this gift of your grace. As we come to you with sins that perhaps we don't even know, we trust that your Spirit is gracious and willing, and that we experience a bit of a new life even in this moment. Remind us of that new life as we hear your promise in holy baptism. Remind us of that new life as we hear your promise again when we leave this life in death. But we ask that your grace would shine on us and shine through us, and that we do make a difference in this world. We take a moment for our own silent prayers at this time. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Would you please stand as we receive the blessing? The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, amen. We go in peace now to serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our final hymn, Christ Be Our Light, hymn number 715.
Longing for light, we wait in darkness. Longing for truth, we turn to you. Make us your own, your holy people, light for the world to see. Christ, be our light, shine in our hearts, shine through the darkness. Christ, be our light, shine in your church, gathered today. Longing for peace, our world is troubled. Longing for hope, many despair. Your word alone has power to save us. Make us your living voice. Christ, be our light. Shine in our hearts. Shine through the darkness. Christ. Longing for food, many are hungry. Longing for water, many still thirst. Make us your bread, broken for others. Share until all are fed. Christ, be our light. Shine in our hearts. Shine through the darkness. Christ, be our light, shine in your church, gathered today. Longing for shelter, our warmth, many are cold. Make us your building, sheltering others, walls made of living stone. Christ, be our light, shine in our hearts, shine through the darkness. Christ, be our light, shine in your church, gathered today. Many the gifts, many the people, many the hearts that yearn to belong. Let us be servants to one another, signs of your kingdom come. Christ, be our light, shine in our hearts, shine through the darkness. Christ, be our light.